Happy Halloween, everyone! This year's Halloween, I decided to make a list of haunted levels from non-horror games. Now, this type of topic has been tackled by our good friend, Fawful's Minion. Thanks to him, I decided to come up with a list like this since last year. Even though Logan made this kind of list 2 years ago, I decided to make my own version so it doesn't look similar to his list, though there is only one level that will be on this list. Now, one per franchise and only games I've played rule still applies, but there are two other rules which are no levels from horror games and M-rated non-horror games are allowed on this list. And most importantly, this is the first level-related list I'm making for the first time. So grab your Halloween stuffs, drinks, and snacks with you because let's rock and roll! I had a fond memories when I first time got into the Arkham series back in 2013 thanks to Batman Arkham Asylum and Arkham City. The atmosphere in both games were excellent, as well as the later games in the series such as the recent Arkham Knight. Now, if we're to find one level that is haunting, we have to go back to the first game, Arkham Asylum, with one of the most memorable segments in the game, the Scarecrow levels. There are three of those levels, and I'm going each of them one by one. The first one starts off when Batman arrives at the lower level of the medical facility, where the Scarecrow has spread the fear gas all across the lower level of the medical facility. After making your way to the lower corridor, you will see Commissioner Gordon begging for help as he's dragged away from you, who you will find him dead. Batman decides to contact Barbara, but instead...
I'm sorry, the number you've dialed isn't available. Please leave a message after the tone.
Barbara... Are you there?
Please hang up your phone.
So you are making your way to find Gordon's killer, where you will find some kind of room with nothing special about it. And after going through the same door whence you came from, takes you to the same room you were just in. There are three body bags, with two of them containing Batman's parents, and the last one has Scarecrow performing a jump scare which transports you to his level. Your goal in each Scarecrow levels is to make your way to the Bat Signal to vanquish Scarecrows while avoiding obstacles and defeating skeleton enemies. The second one starts after Dr. Young is killed and getting out of Arkham Mansion, which triggers Bruce's flashback at Wayne's mansion on the night when Joe Chill killed Bruce's parents, which thanks to Joe Chill made Bruce Wayne into Batman. The second one adds skeleton enemies mentioned earlier that stops you from getting to the Bat Signal. The third one is the biggest mind-screwing in video game history. It starts off by fakely crashing the game and restarting where Joker has caught Batman while driving with the Batmobile to the Arkham Asylum. No pun intended. It is there when Joker pulls the trigger of the gun and giving you the fake game over. And the tip of that game over screen gives you to avoid being shot by using the middle stick, which is the N64 controller. In the last segment, you'll have to defeat all enemies before using the Bat Signal to vanquish Scarecrow one last time and ending all of the Scarecrow levels. Holy crap, these levels were haunting but amazing at the same time. The developer Rocksteady put a lot of thought and effort on these levels, and the Ra's al Ghul level from Arkham City and the Mad Hatter level from both Arkham City and Origins did a great job of what made Scarecrow levels so memorable. And let's not forget the PS4 exclusive Scarecrow levels in Arkham Knight. Not too shabby, Rocksteady.
Okay. Here we go!
The Borderlands franchise is really a fantastic FPS RPG. My favorite game in the franchise is the second game, which takes the positives from the first game and fixes the bad things from the first one and adds new things. Well, except that son of a bitch bastard handsome jackass himself. That's right, Gyuji, you're not alone to hate him. And speaking of Quarter Guy, he was the reason I got into this series. Now, Borderlands 2 doesn't have a haunted level, so we have to go to the first game's level that is a DLC. The Zombie Island of Dr. Ned. Okay, this DLC does not make Borderlands a survival horror game, even though Borderlands is an M-rated franchise. This area is accessed via game's travel system, and once you do, Marcus Kinsey tells you the story of this place. The Zombie Island of Dr. Ned contains 6 areas, which are Jacob's Cove, Hallow's End, Generally Hospital, Dead Haven, Lumberyard, and The Mill. Now, this zombie island has a variety of different zombie enemies, but also Frankensteins, Werskags, a pumpkin head, and the swooping cliff racer-like enemies. Even though there are 6 areas, it is a one huge level to be played, and even though it's a horror themed level, it's a fun to play on Halloween alone or with friends. Now, this level isn't about killing all sorts of undead creatures. It contains 25 missions in this DLC, with 10 of them being story missions about Dr. Ned and 15 side missions. Now, Dr. Ned is the highlight of this DLC, which turns out he is the bad guy of this place, go figure. Once you finally track down Dr. Ned, it's time for you to kill him. And thus the boss fight begins. Wow, he was too easy and lame. Well, time to watch the credits and...
It's not over yet.
Damn, he's not dead? Yes, Dr. Ned decides to go full undead mode and is 100% ready to kick your ass even more than ever. And holy crap, the battle against undead Dr. Ned is way better than his first encounter. Even though he spawns zombies for you to kill for random stuff. And after killing Dr. Ned for real this time, the real credits roll can begin. Man, this was a great level to pick for this list. Even though I never said anything about including horror-themed levels at the beginning of this list, the Zombie Island of Dr. Ned is a really great haunted level, and it's also one of my favorite DLCs in video games. Also, if there is other than me who has seen Scooby-Doo's Zombie Island movie, this level feels like a twisted version of that place. Oh, there is also some Scooby-Doo references in this DLC.
Okay. Here we go!
No. The Lavender Town and the Lavender Tower from Pokemon is really infamous for all its creepypasta crap going on. So I decided to go with the Pokemon game that is my favorite on the DS and the only dungeon that was on Logan's list, which was number 2 on his list. That's right, I'm talking about Strange House from Pokemon Black and White 2. Okay, I have to thank Logan for introducing me to this place before visiting this creepy-ass house, and man oh man, it's freaking spooky. This house is located at Reversal Mountain, and once you enter this house, this music plays. My God! Now the main reason why this is spooky besides the music is the furnitures, which by the way are twitching. And why are they twitching? Well, it's the ghost doing it.
Ghost?
That's right, Ragna. The furniture switch places when you go from the staircase of the other side of the lower floor staircase. And speaking of lower floor of the spooky place, there are some mentions of Hypno, Cresselia, and of course Darkrai. There are 2 fightable trainers in this dungeon, which are a psychic trainer and a backpack trainer. And the wild Pokemons you will encounter in both versions of this game are Raticate, Golbat, Bayonet, and Litwick. In White 2 you will encounter Duosion and Solosis. And in Black 2, Gothrita and Gothita. After progressing through the scary ass house, you come across a dead girl who is a ghost.
Ghost?
Okay, enough, Ragna! This is where the sad incident happened. This is the ghost that was making the furniture twitch and had a dark depressing patch, which by the way was killed by something dark. Which by the way, thanks to Logan's info, was killed by Darkrai. That freaking murderous son of a bitch! Her first encounter says about an endless everlasting dream of darkness while finding her dad, mom, and Abra. Her second encounter says about hearing her dad's voice in her dark dream and forgetting about the lunar wing and someone stays with her. Who is it that stays with her? And when you get to the final room, you'll take the lunar wing and the ghost of the girl appears one last time and tells you to return the wing who was waiting on the bridge that she could return it herself. And then she vanishes, which means her spirit can finally rest. Here's a question. What does that lunar wing do? Well, this thing summons a battle against Cresselia on the Marvelous Bridge, which by the way, I'm not gonna talk about the battle. Speaking of girl and Cresselia, the girl was waiting for Cresselia at Marvelous Bridge so she can return the lunar wing to Cresselia. That was the dead girl's purpose with the lunar wing. So let's finish this. The Strange House is one of the most scariest places in the franchise with its dark past, twitching furnitures, and its music is really unbelievably creepy. And I have to agree with Logan that Lavender Town got nothing on this place. If Frigate Orpheon from Metroid Prime wasn't the only area in the game that made Ishimura from Dead Space series a scary-ass place, then the next place from the Metroid series is gonna make you shake in fear. I'm gonna talk about from my favorite game in the franchise, Metroid Prime 3 Corruption, and its Ishimura precursor level, GFS Valhalla. Holy crap! If USG Ishimura from Dead Space wasn't scary enough, then look no further than GFS Valhalla from Prime 3. Now, this ship was mentioned at the beginning of the game, and after getting the screw attack upgrade, Aurora Unit 242 gives you the location of the wrecked ship. And once you arrive on that place, you'll see all the damage that space pirates have done to this ship. The only way you can progress through the level is finding energy cells throughout the game and put them back where they belong. This place is filled with all sorts of Phazon enemies and also Phazon Metroids. And then there's the easiest hell mini-boss from Pirate's Homeworld and Norian, Metroid Hatcher. Which is no problem because Nova Beam plus X-Ray Visor equals...
best gun ever.
It sure is, Joker. Now this place has two musics and they're both scary. The first one is called Aboard the GFS Valhalla, which means this is the first time you set your footsteps on this scary ass place. And the second one... yeah, it's freaking scary as hell. Now the atmosphere on this place is the best not only in the game, but in the whole franchise. I love the concept of haunted ship levels, whether it's on sea or space, with interesting lore and backstory about what really happened, which by the way is not the only haunted ship level you will see on this list. Now, what is the purpose of coming to this place? Well, after destroying the last Leviathan seed, you must infiltrate the Leviathan ship and gain access to it. But the only way to do that is to find the key code, which is on Valhalla. Once you get to the control room, you will not just find the key code for the Leviathan ship, but you will also find the key code terminal, which contains a message. The code is 78356, and once you have input the code, this message plays up.
Data log entry 2467.3. This will be the last communication of the GFS Valhalla. Our efforts to repel the space pirate boarding force have failed. They have successfully removed the primary mountain structure around our stasis tank. It is obvious now that they intend to extract us from the Valhalla. It is vital that the Federation receive this transmission, severing the main power. A large bioform is creating a wormhole. Implant into sentient planet, which is the source of all Phazon darkness coming.
Well, I'll be damned. This, believe it or not, was the last message of Aurora Unit 313 right before space pirates attacked on Valhalla, which the attack and the virus planting was explained at the beginning of the game. Now, hearing this message and the music at the same time really has a sci-fi horror movie flick into it, and it was very well done in this game thanks to Retro Studios. I know that's the best I can come up with what I thought about the message, so let's wrap this up, will we? If the space station from Metroid Fusion and the frigate Orpheon from Metroid Prime weren't the only scary places in the franchise, then GFS Valhalla will make you soil your pants. And being the Metroid version of USG Ishimura from Dead Space series is really freaking scary. However, there is still one more level left to go.
Okay. Here we go!
Now the previous two entries were from Nintendo games. Number one is the last from a non-Nintendo game. This level has been in my mind since 2009 with its music, backstory of the place, and it's by far my favorite haunted level from non-horror games, and my favorite wrecked ship in all of gaming. And this is one level that has never been mentioned in any countdown maker's list. Ladies and gentlemen, my number one haunted level from non-horror games comes from Tales of Vesperia.
The fog's gotten awfully thick.
Yeah, it's creeping me out.
Fog like this is usually a sign something bad's about to happen.
Knock it off!
Talk like that long enough and something bad will happen.
Hey, front! I mean bow!
We're going to hit them.
What is that? That's an old ship. I've never seen that type before.
I think it says the Atherum.
What the hell is this, you may ask? Well, this is the ghost ship Atherum from Tales of Vesperia, of course. Now, this is the only haunted level in the series because in other Tales games, there is no level like this at all. But Vesperia fixes this problem. So, after getting a boat and traveling to Nordopolica, you and your party comes across a ghost ship. And goddamn, is this place creepy not only because of the design of the dungeon, but also one of the most scariest music in the series composed by the series composer Motoi Sakuraba. Just have a listen. Holy smash, Sakuraba, you really did not disappoint with this scary-ass music. Now before you're starting to explore the ship, you have to pick two more partners because Repeat took the third place in the party. Now the enemy encounter is really creative because the encounter is not random, but you have to look into the mirror to see the enemy if you're gonna engage them in battle. There are all sorts of ghost-like enemies in this place, and also a bird enemy outside of the ship's interior. And after progressing further in the ship, Yuri's team gets trapped with no way to turn back. Where then you're gonna have to control of the three remaining party members. And after getting the three remaining party members through the other parts of the ship, all seven party members are in together. Now the skit conversations are really entertaining. Such as Raven freaking out that there's a hellish monster lurking out. And Rita being scared of ghosts. Are you trying to make me pull off Ragna's scared of ghosts clip again? Well then again, I'm not. After getting the party reunited and going up the stairs, you will find the captain's diary and the red box containing the clear seal crystal in it, and finding the enemies that sneaked up on your party, and making it back to your ship from that cursed ghost ship, and you will continue to sail to Nordopolica. Now this ghost ship really made me wonder if we're gonna see a haunted dungeon after the release of Vesperia, and unfortunately there has never been a haunted dungeon seen later in the series such as Greece's and Exilia 1 and 2. Now why is this number 1, and why this tops Scarecrow segments, The Zombie Island of Dr. Ned, Strange House, and GFS Valhalla? Well, I'll explain. The real reason why this is number 1, like with Strange House and GFS Valhalla, it's due to its backstory of this place. But unlike those two, this backstory is ancient compared to the others. I would like to explain the whole story, but I'll let the game itself explain it for us.
U-232 of Asul, 13th day of Blue Air.
The Asul period and the month of Blue Air are from a time before the Empire.
So, over 1,000 years ago. That long?
Adrift 5 and 40 days. Food and water used up. Men succumbing to thirst and starvation. I cannot give in, though. I must see the clear Ciel crystal safely to Jormungand. This crystal holds the power to banish the monsters, and with it the town may yet be saved. I have stored the clear Ciel crystal in my red chest, a gift from my dear Yuefan. It won't be much longer until I am in her arms again, and then we will all be saved. But he wasn't able to return to his town. He passed away here.
That's right, this place is freaking ancient compared to the other haunted places you have seen this list thus far. And it took place about 1,000 years, older than the events in both the game and the movie First Strike. Now the Clear Seal Crystal I would explain, but I wouldn't do it because I won't spoil the game. And I won't spoil also the PS3 version, and neither should you. So yeah, I chose Ghost Ship Aetherium from Tales of Hesperia as my number one because of its atmosphere, music, design, and the backstory. If there is someone who owns an Xbox 360, buy this game via retail or download. If you don't own a 360, buy the console and get this game. I'm still waiting for this game to be playable on Xbox One. Make it happen! I'm the Electric Izanagi, and if you're setting your foot on this ship, do not bring Ratna because this place is filled with ghosts.
Ghost?
Anyway, happy Halloween, everybody.